Thanks for tuning in to this edition of the Suburban Folk Podcast. We are an independent podcast, so we appreciate all listener support that we receive. And we also try to support other independent podcasts, such as my friends over at the Round and Round Podcast.
Hey, this is Jeff.
And I'm Chris.
We've been friends.
Acquaintances.
No, friends.
Shipmates.
Dude, come on. We've been friends.
Fine. Sure. Whatever. We've been friends for 23? No, 24.
Whatever, dude. It's been a long time.
No kidding. We host a show called Round and Round. We discuss the worst.
And sometimes the best.
Headlines we can find. Watch for signs of the Cold War heating up again. And desperately try to find some good news to celebrate. Occasionally, we delve into important topics impacting the world, the nation, or those around us.
And every once in a while, we take a break from the real world to talk about new movies or to revisit and reimagine old movies we love. Find us at rnrthepodcast.com, tweet us at rnrthepodcast, and download Round and Round on Apple Podcast, Spotify, iHeartRadio, or wherever you cast your pods. Join us every Wednesday, won't you?
I wouldn't recommend it.
That's fine.
Health, travel, finance, parenting, and home improvement. This is the Suburban Folk Podcast.
$250 a month into my child's 529 from the month that they start kindergarten, I should be able to pay for 80% of my child's college.
Because I don't trust that most people will eat their vegetables. Right. So usually our kind of standard is 3 servings of vegetables per meal.
You take something like a 2x6 and you cut it with a circular saw. That's like a superpower.
Those middle school years are not as fun, but at that age, they're still willing to talk to you.
Welcome to the Suburban Folk Podcast. I'm your host, Greg. Today's topic is around personal finance, specifically how you can take historical examples and apply them to your everyday finances. My guest is John Vespasian. He's the author of 10 books about rational living. His most recent book is called Undisrupted, How Highly Effective People Deal with Disruptions. Vespasian has lived in Germany, Italy, France, Spain, and the Netherlands. His books combine his passion for history, investing, and personal development, reflecting his philosophy of rational living, productiveness, and respect for the individual. John, thanks so much for joining the show today. I really appreciate it.
Thanks, Greg. Thanks for having me on.
So to kick us off, can you just walk us through your background? How did you get to the point of becoming an author and your focus on historical examples and then leading into dealing with disruption ultimately with your most recent book?
Yes, I started to write books about personal development, personal finance, anything related to career development 10 years ago. And the reason why I started to write books, which in principle doesn't sound like a very good business idea to write books, because it takes a lot of work and it's difficult to make money writing books. It has other benefits. But the reason why I started to do that was out of sheer frustration. I've been reading books for decades about personal development, personal finance, career development. And at a certain point, I became very frustrated about the kind of books I could find in the market, because I found most advice rather unrealistic, very much focused on feelings, on anecdotes, not on real experience. So what I've done in my books, and this is number 10, the one that came out recently, is to go through history, to go through dozens and dozens of biographies of people in different centuries, different professions, different backgrounds, to try to draw from their experience, from their success and from their failure, to try to draw lessons we can apply in the 21st century. The books lean heavily on my background, which is an international background. I've been working in different countries. I lived in Belgium, in France, in Italy for a while, in Germany, now in the Netherlands. So it has a very much an international approach. I try to use examples that can relate to anyone in any country. There are examples from different cultures, but they focus heavily on my interest in personal success, personal development, and also on financial markets.
Is there a universal definition of success? This is sort of a leading question because I think the answer is no. For example, you said writing books is very hard to really make money for it. So I gotta imagine that the definition of success is not necessarily straight monetary, but are there similar concepts of what success would be when people are starting to see what they can do for a career development?
Yes, I think there is a pattern. And if you go through my books, you will see, I mean, dashes and dashes of biographies in different fields. And there is a pattern you find in almost every successful person, which is the following. It is not that people are setting goals to become something specific, because most successful people, actually, when you look at the biography, you don't see any goals. You don't see any goal setting in a very specific way. This is something that psychologists have constructed in retrospective. But when you look at the biographies, you don't see this kind of pattern. What you see, I think, in almost 99.9% of successful people is a very strong sense of direction, which doesn't mean focus on money necessarily. They have, with very few exceptions, they have a very focused interest in an area which sometimes is difficult to make money from at the beginning. But eventually they figure out how to turn it into a business, into a successful profession, into some kind of career. And you see this pattern in ancient history. You see this pattern in the Middle Ages. You see this pattern in the 19th century. You see this pattern today. I think it's a universal human pattern that if you develop a strong interest in some area, which might be sometime exoteric, some might be, for instance, personally, for instance, I'm very much interested in languages. I speak several languages. I love learning languages. I'm currently, for instance, learning Russian, which at a certain point, it requires a lot of effort. You cannot really see when you start doing this kind of stuff an immediate benefit. But of course, when you look at it in terms of 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, you see at the end that it was a good idea, because I found and you find a way to use this knowledge. So I repeat, this is a sense of direction, a sense of knowing what you like, what you don't like, that actually pushes successful people through decades of steady work. And eventually, when you see these very successful people in retrospect, you say, you see, the story was clear. He was heading to this goal, and this is not true. It happens very often that people don't know exactly what they want. They just go into the direction. They basically ignore negative criticism from other people saying, why are you doing this? Why are you doing this? It doesn't make sense. But it makes sense to them, and eventually they find a way to use it. And I think this is a very practical definition of success, very much individual related. But when you look at history, when you look at real examples, and this is what I do in my books, you see this pattern is almost universal, and I think it's a very good, very practical, very realistic definition of success.
You mentioned being able to figure out a way to sell whatever the service or item, whatever it is that the person is passionate about, because I'm guessing that's what we're talking about here, is you're setting a goal, which means presumably you're passionate about whatever the thing you're pursuing. How much does considering what the market is looking for, and I know that's a very broad question when we're talking about, you know, sort of decades over decades, centuries over centuries, but what did you see in the examples that you researched for folks that were successful? Were they, like you're mentioning, just always dead set that whatever their goal was is what they were going to do, and didn't really pay that much attention to what the market was telling them they should be doing? Or is there some sense of taking the thing you're passionate about and maybe the thing that is going to end up being your life's work and is sustainable is close to that, but you've changed it a little bit because it's more in line with what will actually make a living for yourself?
Yeah, actually, there is no contradiction. I think it's better if I just present some examples, because the idea that you develop some skill, I don't know, whatever, you learn to fix cars or to repair cars, and then you find a way as a mechanic. Yeah, this is like very easy to put it in this way. But actually, human life is much more complicated, because sometimes happens very often that people learn things that look completely worthless. They have hobbies, they have interests, they have, skills that they gather. Most people don't exploit them. Most people, they have this idea that, okay, you learn to be a mechanic and then you just work as a mechanic and that's it. And then you have your hobbies and then you watch TV and that's life. But when you look at successful people, it doesn't work like this. For instance, let me give you a few examples from my latest book. One of the biographies I present in the book, which shows this pattern of what I call a sense of direction. It's the story of Joseph Paxton, who was a British gardener from the 19th century. From a gardener, eventually he became a very successful architectural consultant and a very successful architect. And the story is fascinating because the guy didn't have an education. He started to work as an assistant gardener when he was 14 years old. He barely went to school. Huh? I mean, he could read at the beginning, but not very fluently. And eventually, because he was very curious, he was ambitious, he wanted to make something out of his life, he started to try to improve the area. He was working in a big estate in the north of England. He started to plant different trees. He wanted to improve things, but he didn't know much. And just by sheer trial and error, he started to experiment with glass houses, which in the 19th century was one of the big innovations in gardening. He built a few very primitive glass houses in this estate. And eventually he became very good at building glass houses, but he didn't make much money. But he found it fascinating. He started to write articles in newspapers. Then he started a gardening magazine, but he didn't make a lot of money. He could not find the job. And he did it for almost 20 years. And it's fascinating. This guy was developing his expertise without finding a real outlet for his talent. And eventually, as it happens very often in these stories, eventually he found an opportunity. He found there was a call for tender in London to build an exhibition hall. For a great exhibition, universal exhibition, and he submitted a bid to build a huge glass house instead of building a brick building. All the architectural firms in London, they submitted proposals, but Paxton, who was a gardener, who was an expert in glass houses, was the only one who was able to provide a design that was very much low cost, could be built very quickly, and could be dismantled very quickly. And he designed this building almost in a week. And when you see the way he won the call for tender, it's fascinating because he used all his expertise. He used his expertise in design, glass houses. He used his expertise in media because he had been writing articles or newspapers about gardening for years. So he knew a lot of newspapers, editors. So he sent his design to several newspapers in London to make sure that he got a lot of publicity. And during the call for tender, he was in all the newspapers. He was getting interviews. So eventually he got the contract and he delivered the building under budget and ahead of time. And a building that he designed for 6 months eventually was used for 30 years. So profitably was extremely profitable, the building. And then he became very famous and he became a designer of country houses for the Rothschild family. Now, this kind of career, which you see involves a lot of very strong sense of direction because the guy was curious. He wanted to develop his career. He wanted to learn. He wanted to try different things, but he didn't have a goal. You cannot say that Paxton, from the very beginning, wanted to become a millionaire. He wanted to become a famous architect. It is not the case. The guy, for almost 15 years, almost 20 years, he was just struggling to increase his income, and eventually he found a good opportunity because he had built such a combination of skills that was completely unique. And eventually he found a good opportunity and he became very famous and very wealthy. And this is the perfect example of a career development, I would say, when people develop skills because something they like, they have a passion, they are ambitious, they are constantly learning. And eventually, when you see in retrospective, you construct this story of having a goal, which is false. I mean, the guy didn't have a goal. And I present many of these stories in the book with different patterns to show how people actually can profit from this strategy.
I think there's a lot to learn from that story. What I'm hearing you say is an emphasis on the willingness to learn and grow, especially if you're starting out in an industry or a place where you don't necessarily have the ability to make a living. Well, then learn whatever the skill is or whatever the other things are that maybe are related to. And once you amass those skills, then like in this example, you may have something very, very unique that becomes something that's needed by the market, or just get you into a whole different industry altogether. So definitely I would say that that's for sure. Being naturally curious and then willing to figure out how stuff works. How much do you find that fear of the unknown and sort of staying away from personal growth gets in the way for folks? And, you know, how should they deal with that so that they are continuing to amass skills and, you know, becoming more marketable?
Nowadays, you cannot really open a book about psychology or personal development without reading about this positive thinking and this law of attraction, and that you should just do it and do not get stopped by your fear. And you see this tendency to push people forward without much thought. I think this is very unrealistic, this philosophy. Unfortunately, today it dominates 99% of the market for psychology, personal advice, counseling, and this kind of stuff. It's very unfortunate, because when you look at history and you look at real cases of people, you almost never see successful people trusting their future to positive thinking. So it's normal to have fear. It's very dangerous to convince yourself through suggestion that you can do anything. One of the patterns I really present in the book, which is confirmed by dozens of examples, is that people who do very well in times of adversity, in times of bankruptcy, when they get sick, when they lose the job, when they get a divorce, people who do very well tend to fall back on skills, on relationships, on territories, on areas they know very well. And people who systematically are going to fail, and you see hundreds of examples in history, these are people who improvise, who get into careers, into businesses, into areas they know nothing about. They feel very confident, maybe because they are very foolish, but it is playing against the odds. This is like today when you see all these stories in newspapers that you see these Hollywood actors, and they make a fortune, and then they lose it by investing in some stupid, I don't know, restaurant or something. Or these basketball players that they make a fortune, and then they buy shares in some gold mine in Africa. I mean, these stories, they have been happening for hundreds of years. Is that it's very unfortunate that human beings tend to repeat the same patterns. But the message, main messages from the book, is that you have to learn to go through a learning curve. You have to be patient. You have to know what you know and what you don't know. And the very worst thing you can do in any area of life is to improvise. If you want to invest in the stock market, which I really recommend everybody to learn at least the basics of investing in the stock market in the long term, you have to go through a learning curve. You can start by opening a brokerage account, by making small investments, by following the market. You have to start somewhere, but you have to go through a learning curve. There is no magic. You cannot just rely on some guru who's going to tell you what to do. You have to learn yourself, and it's going to take time. Do not improvise. Realize that whatever you want to do in life, you have to learn. It's going to take some time. It's going to take some effort, but you can do it. I mean, in the book, I present many examples of people who wanted to get into a different business or in a different area. They realized they didn't know anything about it, and they learned little by little, and they became very, very successful. But this is the way to do it. It is not magic. It is not positive thinking. It's prudence. It's good to have fear, because fear will protect you. You just have to be able to deal with it by learning what you have to learn.
I would definitely second what you're talking about with learning the stock market. That was, I went through that kind of a learning curve, and you know, just like anything, I'm sure there's plenty more that I could figure out. Actually, when we do any of our financial shows, I try to emphasize, hey, we understand that people are coming into this brand new. So if we talk about, you know, acronyms or shorthand ways of describing things, try to do our best to explain what they are so that people don't feel too lost in what we're discussing. So again, I would definitely second what you're saying for anybody to have at least some understanding of the stock market. And again, like you said, realizing that it's something new to be learned, just like anything else that you've learned, you'll get it eventually. There is a curve that'll take a little bit of time. I also think that wrapping that together with your career aspirations, the better you are at your investing and the smarter you can be with budgeting and so on, then potentially the more options you have career-wise, because you're not necessarily having to do the same things that you don't want to do, let's say, day over day, because you haven't left yourself any room financially to grow from there. And the other thing that strikes me in how you're describing being innovative and especially in hard times, being adaptive, is this term, the gig economy, that I think has gotten more popular over the years. And, you know, taking the things that you are good at and maybe have just been a hobby and figuring out a way to maybe have a little bit of a side business with it and, you know, seeing where that goes. Is that something that you're familiar with? And just based on these concepts, do you think the gig economy is a good thing, or is it maybe just something that's distracting people from ultimately reaching whatever their potential should be if they were just focused on one task?
Yeah, I think we have to learn from history in these cases to avoid misunderstandings. Because the idea that you can make a living as a consultant selling your services sporadically now and then, and you're going to do an event here and you're going to do something there, and you're going to, it's like performing, like if you are a performing artist, yes, you are going to get bookings from time to time. But what is behind is a massive career investment in the long term. It's not that it happens by chance. And let me just give you an example from the book. One of the successful careers that I present in the book is the story of Rubens. He was a painter, very successful painter in the 17th century. And I find the story fascinating because while Rubens was making really a fortune, I mean, he really made a huge fortune as an artist, which is the gig economy. Yeah, yeah. He was painting and he was selling his paintings one by one. And he had to find every painting was a project, so to speak. And he made a huge fortune. And what is fascinating is that at the same time, when Rubens was becoming very successful in Antwerp, in Belgium, you see all the painters in the environment, like, for instance, Vermeer is a very famous painter from the same period. And while Rubens was painting almost five paintings a week, Vermeer was doing one every 6 months, barely making any money. Vermeer never managed to turn his gig into a career because he was doing something else. He could not make enough money from painting, even if he was, I think, much better than Rubens. He couldn't make enough money because he didn't figure out the marketing part. He didn't figure out the productivity part. He didn't figure out the creativity part. And Rubens did something very clever, because when he was in his 20s and he wanted to become a painter, he realized it was very difficult. And this is what most people don't realize. When they are talking about the gig economy, most people don't realize how difficult it is to maintain this kind of project-based career in the long term. I mean, you can do it for a few months, but to do it for years and to do it successfully, you need to become actually very productive, very effective in your marketing. And Rubens, when he was in his 20s and he realized it was almost impossible to make a living as a painter, because there were a million painters in the 17th century earning some money as a hobby. It was the same as today. You see a million people playing guitar in cafes, in bars. They're gigs, but they don't make any money. And Rubens realized that the only way to turn his gigs into a business was to copy the best practices. So he realized that nobody was making any money in his city in Antwerp painting. They were all amateurs, but they barely make any money. So he looked around and said, who is making money? Who's making money with these gigs? He realized that the only people who were making money, they were in Italy. In Italy, painters made a huge amount of money, in Florence, in Rome, in Venice. So Rubens traveled to Italy. He was there almost for a year. He stayed in Florence, Venice, in Rome. And he actually talked to the successful painters, and he realized that what they were doing was very different from what he thought. Because people have this idea of the painters as a creative guy who makes a painting in his garret and then he sells the painting to a gallery. I mean, it's really a very Hollywood movie idea, but it's not very realistic. I mean, you cannot make any money like this. Rubens went to Italy. He realized that the big Italian painters like Tiepolo, they had a marketing system. They had employees. They had extremely high productivity. And when he went back to Antwerp, he copied what he had learned, and he turned his gig economy, so to speak, into a business. And he developed a very sophisticated marketing system. He developed an extremely high productivity. He hired people to finish his paintings that he pre-designed. Even he hired people to read books to him, to read aloud while he was painting, to get him more ideas. And he hired students from the seminar in Antwerp to come to his workshop to read books to him so that he could get more ideas for paintings. I mean, he developed a factory of creativity. And this is fascinating. While all the other painters were barely making a living, many of them were starving, actually, Rubens made a huge fortune. And it's not a coincidence. To turn this gig economy or this economic idea, this project-based approach into a business, into a successful career, you need to copy these kind of techniques, because otherwise you will be wiped out by the first disruption. And this is what I try to show in the book. If you want to build a solid career, solid finances, solid skills, you have to copy this kind of patterns from history, because people have gone through this experience before. You don't need to reinvent the wheel. You just have to look at people like Rubens to see how they did it. And today in the 21st century, you can use exactly the same principles.
And we're talking about scalability here, right? I mean, to sort of boil it down. And it's interesting because I probably, if you would ask me if painting is scalable, to your point, you know, if you're not thinking outside of the box, it probably doesn't seem like it. But Rubens found a way to actually get that done. Have you found in your research that there's any particular industry or hobby or skill that just isn't scalable no matter what somebody does, that maybe isn't the thing to make your business?
Well, if you operate in a very small market, and Rubens realized very quickly, for instance, imagine that you work and you're making musical instruments by hand, and then you just have to buy the precious wood, and you cut, I don't know, the violins and this kind of stuff. It's difficult to make a very good living like that because the market is relatively small. Yeah, you can find customers and you can sell your products, but it's not a huge market. And Rubens, when he went to Italy, he realized that you have to have a marketing system wherever you do. When he went to Italy, he realized that actually the market for paintings was split in several segments, because when people think about artists, I don't know, music or whatever, they don't apply the same logic as when you're running a company. Because when you're running a company, you realize you have to have segmentation in your marketing, you have to focus your advertising on the right target. And Rubens, in the 17th century, he went to Italy and said, I didn't realize there were several markets, actually. There is a market for portraits, there is a market for landscapes, there is a market for religious painting, and he realized that the marketing approach for each of them was different. And when he went back to Italy, Belgium, to Antwerp, he realized that he had to operate on different markets if he wanted to make a living, because it was very risky to have only one customer. If you were for the church, and many people in the 17th century were for the church, it was very risky because if you got some conflict with the church, and it was really always very difficult because you might make a painting that was a bit controversial and then you were out, it was very risky. So Rubens did what artists should do. He segmented his market. He developed marketing strategies for different segments. And he sold portraits to the families. He sold religious paintings to the church. And he sold landscapes to the average family. And he made money in all the markets because he developed marketing strategies for all those. I mean, just to give you an idea, for instance, Rubens, every time he went out of his home in Antwerp, he always carried with him a sketchbook. And he went constantly to dinners, to parties, to all kind of meetings, and he always carried his sketchbook. And as soon as he met someone new, he made quickly with a carbon, he made a sketch of a painting and said, would you like to buy this? And he proposed constantly, 10 times a day, possible ideas for paintings to everybody he met. And this is how he got, constantly, he got new commissions. And how many artists are doing this in the 21st century? Very few. People are just waiting for creativity and magic to happen. But if you want to transform your career into a supercharged, successful machine, you have to copy from history. Don't expect magic, don't expect positive thinking to help you. Copy from history. Just imitate people who made a living, who became very successful, and who were able to go through disruptions without a scratch.
Let's stay on marketing just for a minute, because especially in the creative arts world, I think that a lot of people would probably say, well, I'm not a salesperson. Now, this goes back to the fear thing that we were talking about. Do you find that if that's outside of somebody's comfort zone to really be marketing and sort of pushing their product, should they just fight through the fear and get used to it themselves? Is there any sort of an option for outsourcing the marketing, so getting a business partner or something like that? What do you recommend there?
Well, depends on the business you're operating. I mean, if you are a pop artist, I mean, you have to get to the stage and you have to sing. I mean, otherwise, I mean, it doesn't work. Unless you are a composer and you don't want to deal with the public. But if you're in any kind of business you are, and let me just give you another example from the book. In any kind of business you are, you have to realize what you really want to do, what kind of skills you have, and what you hate. It's perfectly fine if you hate some part of the business. For instance, Rubens hated the coloring, so he did the design of the draft of the painting, but then he hired people to put the colors because really it was really a horrible work. I mean, you have to make the colors by hand by mixing grease with pigments and all kind of flowers. I mean, it was really horrible work. So he hired 10 people to do that, and he hated to do that. Most painters in the 17th century did it themselves. And Rubens said, no, I'm not going to do that. It's horrible. I'm not going to do it. So he never did it. Another example. For instance, another career I present in the book is Robert Stephenson and George Stephenson. And they were investors in railroads in the 19th century. And they built a big part of the railroad infrastructure in the UK. And they were father and son. I mean, the father, George Stephenson, he developed some improvements in locomotives. And his son, Robert Stephenson, he didn't like the business. I mean, he studied engineering and chemistry, but he didn't want to make locomotives because he didn't like it. I mean, he was not interested in mechanical stuff. He wanted to do finances. So he focused his career, basically, for 50 years, he was almost only doing project finance. And he would find an idea to build the railroads between two cities in the UK. He raised the money from investors. He created a company to run the project, incorporated the company, and then he sold the project to the UK Parliament to get a concession. I mean, he did it 100 times. And he knew that he didn't like to deal with people a lot because he was very much a very intellectual guy. And he concentrated on this part of the business. So he did finance for 50 years without actually focusing on other areas. He hired people, for instance, to do the designs of the railroads. He hired people to do the procurement of the locomotives, and he focused on the finance. And he became super sharp in this particular area because it was his, what I always call, the sense of direction. The guy realized that this was what he wanted to do. He liked very much to package projects, to sell the ideas to investors. And he left the actual implementation to different people. So these kind of careers, they can be very successful, but you have to know yourself. You have to realize that you cannot learn everything. You cannot do everything. Eventually, if you hate to do something, you can subcontract it, you can hire someone to do it, you can design your career or your products so that you don't have to do this kind of stuff, and then you can be successful. I mean, today we live in a very complex society with this. We have a lot of concentration of focusing on different areas. We have this distribution of work where people have different interests, so you can always find someone to do what you don't want to do. You just have to pay the price. So I think it's a good comment, but you should not be discouraged from becoming an artist or becoming a banker or becoming whatever just because you don't like one specific thing. You can always get around it. As long as you are very good in some area, you can do very well.
Maybe connecting that back to being adaptable to certain skills, it behooves you to try out whatever the different aspects of the business are, like a marketing or, you know, like you mentioned, the mixing paints or whatever the thing is. So at least you've said you've done it and know whether or not you don't like it or not. And I would imagine that would even allow you the ability to, A, figure out what the cost is going to be to have somebody else do it for you, be just figure out if it's worth it or if it's something that needs to be included in what you're doing from a business standpoint. And then also, once you hire those people, if you have at least tried the task that you're hiring somebody to do, you probably have a good idea of whether or not they're doing it well or not. What makes me think of, for example, is when we do our home improvement episodes, we talk about whenever you need to bring in a contractor to do your plumbing or your electrical or something like that. And yeah, maybe you don't want to do the work. Maybe you're not ready to do it. But if you've done other types of projects, you can at least sort of oversee and make sure they're doing what they're supposed to be doing and, you know, aren't doing a bad job and then just charging you for it. So there probably is at least some benefit to trying most of the aspects of whatever business you find yourself in so that you can at least get an appreciation for what goes into it, even if you discover you're not that good at it. Does that sound about right?
I think that most people, by the time you are in your 20s, most people know what they don't like. I think the human psychology is built, almost fully built, by the time you are in your 23, 24, 25. And people change very little. In terms of the structure of their psychology, their taste, their ideology, their personality, you don't find a lot of changes. Huh? When people hate mathematics and they are, I don't know, 12 years old, you rarely see someone turning around and say, no, I'm going to love mathematics and be a mathematician for the rest of my life. It's very rare. But you can already see in teenagers a clear inclination in some area. And okay, maybe it's good if you have time to go through different experiences, but for most people, if you really know what you don't like and you know more or less what you like, why should you try to force yourself to go through the torture of doing something you hate for years? And this is something that is not self-evident because we tend to have a very unrealistic idea about markets if you are not in the market. When you're not really doing something every day and you don't know the different segments of the market, you don't know the prices, you don't know the speed of the transactions, you don't know the best advertising channels, we tend to have a very unrealistic picture. You have a very romantic, sometimes people have a very romantic idea of how business works. And when you actually get through the learning curve, you realize that many things you expected are wrong, and that many things you thought were super complicated and super easy because someone has invented some software or some machine or some coating to solve the problem, you thought it was impossible. So you have to go through a learning curve. But generally speaking, if you can really avoid doing things you hate, life is very short. I would not really spend a lot of time doing that. Try to follow your inclinations. I always underline, try to go through the process of developing a very strong sense of direction. A sense of direction, I think, is the key not only to a good career, but also to personal happiness.
One other question when considering doing the things that you're good at and that you like and avoiding as much as you can the ones that you don't, how much does finances play a part in that consideration? So, for example, if I'm just starting out my own business, should I maybe suck it up and take on certain tasks on my own because it's going to be cheaper in the short term? Or should I be looking more long term and say, okay, let's take on some debt or, you know, do whatever I need to do to get some cash rolling in so that I can right out of the gate sub out some of these activities and really hit the ground running?
This depends on the speed of the growth. Because if you say, okay, I can subcontract 99% of the business and do only marketing because I'm very good and I'm going to grow at 30% per year, then you can subcontract from day one. Because then if you see the growth in revenue, then you can afford a lot of mistakes, you can afford a lot of subcontracting. But this is not the case for most people. And why? This is because the learning curve. When you are getting into a new business or a new activity, the level of ignorance is so huge that you don't even realize what is the best configuration of the task. You don't even know what you should subcontract or not because you don't know the whole process. And it's very difficult to conceptualize all the steps, the different costs, the connection between the different steps. Is very difficult to get it smoothly from the beginning if you don't have really an insight in this kind of stuff. The cases where you are mentioning that a person starts a business and then he decides, so I'm going to do marketing and everything else I'm going to subcontract. These are usually people who have been in this kind of business for 20 years. They know exactly how it works. They know all the process flow. They know all the steps. And they know how to set it up perfectly from the beginning. They even know whom to hire and how much to pay. If you don't have this level of detailed knowledge, I think it's better to start slowly to keep your cash to pay for mistakes you're going to make, because you will make a lot of mistakes, until you have something that makes a profit, a small profit, and then you can scale it. But for most people, to start from scratch and to get it right at the very beginning and to grow at 30% per year, for most people and most businesses, this is not realistic. You should not take an outlier from history and say, okay, this guy did it, because you might not be able to replicate it. I think you have to know what you know, what you don't know. And when you find a way to grow very fast, do it. But until you get to that level, it was like Rubens. I mean, Rubens, until he put together his machine, his marketing machine, I mean, it took him almost 5 years because he was struggling to get things together. But eventually, when he had the machinery of the business functioning, he was growing extremely quickly.
And then let's pivot a little bit over to the finance piece. Of course, we talked about that at the very beginning of personal finances. And like I said, I definitely second what you're saying. People need to dedicate at least some time in understanding investing and budgeting and what they're doing with their money. And I think a lot of the concepts that we're talking about probably directly apply to how people manage their money, as far as learning as much as you can, picking up additional skills. In this case, I think you'd be talking about understanding different investments. What do you recommend for folks to start to build their knowledge in the world of personal finance?
For instance, in the book, I present in great detail the biography of Bernard Baruch. He was a financier. He died in 1965. And he was a very famous investor in the 1950s, 1960s. he made a great fortune in the stock market. And I think the first step for people to realize when you're talking about personal finance is that you are going to live for easily 85, 90, 95 years today. So you have to realize that unless you have a plan to keep your standard of living at a good level and to have income until your very last day, it's very risky just to go about your business every day, your career, without thinking about the long term. I mean, you don't have to think in terms of hundreds of years or 200 years, but you do need to think in terms of 90 years, because most people today, if they get old, they live to 90, 95, and you need to have a system to cover your expenditures at the time where you won't be able to work, or at least you won't be able to work with a lot of physical energy. How do you do that? From history, we see different strategies. I'm talking about people who are not spending their whole life watching the stock market. I mean, I'm talking about people who have a career and want to keep their investments separately. So I would say that when you look at history, most people are either going to invest in houses for rent, I mean, rental property, which is relatively time intensive, because you have to spend time finding the investments, furnishing, renting. And to be clear, this is not feasible in some markets. If you are not living in an area where renting is a good business, I don't know, if you're in the US, possibly you can do this in Texas or, I don't know, in Florida. But there are other areas where this is a terrible idea, because the market is very, very, I mean, I guess if you are living in Baltimore, you cannot make any money renting houses. It's this horrible market. So this is one way. But nowadays in the 21st century, I think for 99% of the people, investing in the stock market is a better idea, because it's easier. It is cheaper, because the transaction costs are very, very low. The information, the cost of information is very, very low, and you can spread your investments in different countries, in different industries, in different types of assets very easily. And it doesn't take a lot of time. If you go through the learning curve and you read some books and you start investing every month, even if you do with the small amounts. Because I was talking to a friend the other day, and she was hesitating whether to invest in the stock market. And she was afraid of losing her money. I found it very, very strange, because she just finished an MBA, a master administration degree. I said, how is it possible? I mean, you've done an MBA and you are not confident enough to invest in the stock market, even a small amount. So eventually, I tried to convince her to open a brokerage account to start reading the news every day about the stock market. I mean, even if it's only 10 minutes. And to invest a small amount, invest $100 per month, buy shares of, I don't know, some easy company. I mean, I don't know, Citibank or Microsoft or whatever. Buy shares and then watch them and get some confidence until you can do other things. So buy an ETF of the index. But you have to go through the learning curve. And it's very easy to do, much easier, I think, than buying houses. For most people, the idea of buying a house and rent a house to fix it, to find tenants, to actually keep an eye on the repairs and this kind of stuff, for most people, is not feasible because you need a good market. You need to have some personal inclination to do this kind of stuff. It's small. I mean, in the end, you're running a small business. I think for most people, I say 90%, 95%, the stock market is a better approach when you're talking how to invest your money for your decades, because you are talking about investing for the next decades until you are very old. It is easy. The transaction costs are very low. Nowadays, I mean, come on, how much do you pay for a transaction with an internet broker? You're talking a small amount. I think people are just too afraid of history, because they know that maybe their grandparents, they lost money in the 1920s, or maybe they went through the internet bubble, I don't know, 20 years ago, and they still remember it. If you do it carefully and you go through learning curve and you don't go crazy and you learn little by little, I think it's a very good choice. It's something that was not available in history 10 years ago, 15 years ago. It was very expensive still to have a brokerage account. Today, you can put your whole portfolio on Google Documents, on Google Spreadsheets. It updates every 20 seconds, and you don't have to pay anything. I mean, it's astonishing. The level of access that private investors have today has never happened in history. But for most people, they have this very romantic idea of the stock market. They have a very unrealistic idea of risk. And they have to go through the learning curve. Otherwise, you will stay on the sides. And when you are 80 or 90, you will regret it. Because you could have invested, you could accumulate it, assets, and if you don't do anything, nothing is going to happen.
And a quick anecdote to the comparison with rental real estate compared to a stock portfolio. I know here in the U.S., there are a lot of services to take care of the things that you talked about that can be the headaches for rental property. Like, you know, you can pay a service to find you a tenant and be the maintenance guy if something goes wrong, collect the rent, et cetera, et cetera. But of course, you're paying them. So it goes back to the same concept that we were talking about before of considering what you are okay doing and what you're not okay doing. And I actually had the situation because when we moved to where we live now, I was not able to sell my house. So I rented it for a while. And one thing that I would share with folks, if you do think you're going to do rentals and you're going to hire out a company to, again, find the tenant and do all that stuff, well, they charge you for any like handyman fees or something like that. And the reason why that becomes a bit of an issue is it's almost like they are rewarded for finding things with your house that they say need to be updated or your rental property, which of course is costing you more money in their pocket. And even with the stock market, if you're, let's say, using a broker, you know, you have a financial advisor, at least you're both on the same page about the incentive for if it increases, it's good for them and it's good for you. So you're sort of on the same page, whereas there is a little bit of a disincentive if you do have a company to help you manage your rental properties. Now, otherwise, if you are able to spend the time and it is something that you like to be able to do, it might be an option. But also to your point of the amount of investments that are available in the stock market, I mean, heck, at this point, there are mutual funds, ETFs that are specific for real estate. So like you mentioned, if you find yourself in an area where real estate just is not really an option because it's not a heavily populated area or not a desirable area, whatever the case may be, there are investment options in the stock market that are based on real estate. And I think even can be geographical based on the way that they're put together, as well as the type. Like I know there are certainly like commercial real estate investments that you can invest in. I assume there are probably residential ones as well, but I'd have to do some more research on that. And I think basically what we're saying here using that comparison is this is kind of the risk mitigation part that you were talking about earlier as well, right? That, you know, you want to be diverse in the stock market. Again, it sounds like that has a pretty good correlation to career and career growth. Am I on the right track that's a very specific thing you need to be looking for is spread out, in this case, your investments so that you're more protected from a particular industry or a particular type of investment going way up or way down.
Yes, what you want to have, in addition to the diversification, you want to have a routine, something that you can do every month. If you invest, most people are going to invest once a month. So you get your salary and you say, okay, I'm going to invest a few hundred dollars. You develop a routine to get the money, to find an investment, which might be very easy. You just mentioned you could be an ETF. I say ETF for, I don't know, some REITs for malls. So you can invest, I don't know, in shipping or whatever you want. You put the money every month. You get develop the routine. It might take you an hour or a couple of hours per month. But then you just do it and then you just feel better and you develop this self-discipline, which will help you in many areas. And in addition to that, I have to say that one of the virtues of international investment, when you invest in the stock market, You would put some money, say, in China, you put some money in India, you put some money in Germany. It makes people very open to other countries. One of the problems, I think, of the 21st century is that people are becoming very narrow-minded. They fear foreigners, they fear immigration, they fear competition. It is very sad because what creates innovation, what creates a very high standard of living that we enjoy in Europe, in the US, in other countries, is based on openness and competition, on freedom, on innovation. And when you invest in the stock market, you have access to all this because you can invest in the best companies in China, you can invest in the best companies in Germany, in the best companies in France. And you have access to that, and you feel a part of a growing world with innovation, with competition, with freedom, with productivity. I think when people are fearful and they just close their eyes and they retreat in their homes and they close the door and they don't want to hear anything about free trade or innovation or competition or immigration, this is very bad. It's very bad for them. I think it's very unrealistic. You cannot really have you cannot really develop yourself as a person if you are driven by fear. And the best thing about investing is that it's going to open your eyes to many opportunities, to many countries, to many companies, and it's going to remove your fear. Because if you do it little by little, and you start investing a few hundred dollars here, a few hundred dollars there. I mean, even if you just open a brokerage account and you put $50 and you buy an ETF, I tell you, after a few months, you will feel a new person because you will see, oh, I have shares in China. I have bought an ETF in Vietnam. I have invested in BMW. I have invested in whatever. I mean, you start to get a new understanding of what is going on in the world. You start to understand the news better. You start to be focused instead of what most people do. It's just very pessimistic talk. You start to see the opportunities and you start to see the innovation. And I think investing not only will make you wealthier, I think it will make you a better person because you will be more attuned to international developments. And you will be, I think, more peaceful, because if everybody had investments in different countries, I tell you, people will be much more peaceful and much more open to trade instead of trying to constantly trying to be hostile against other countries, which I think is a very bad thing for the future. And I recommend really everybody to start with international investment, because you will become not only wealthier, but also, I think, a more open-minded person.
A couple of points there to highlight that you're actually hitting some themes that we've discussed on prior episodes. Actually, in some travel episodes we've talked through, I referenced a book by Steven Pinker called Enlightenment Now, and I actually happened to read it right at the beginning of this year. So I'm sort of using it as my mantra for this year and beyond. That he points out through a whole lot of different statistics as far as poverty rates and wars, things like that, that we're actually living in probably the best time in history ever. It's just that with all the information that we have and everything being reported, it seems a whole lot worse. And so what to take from that, and I think, like you're saying, even with the investing world, don't think that everything is so negative that you sort of curl up in your shell and do nothing and think that everything is awful, because that's only going to be bad for you. Because when in reality, like you said, there really is a lot of opportunity out there. And we focused on it in our travel episodes. But yeah, it does make sense that you can also feel more connected in the investment world by expanding your knowledge and expanding what's going on. And I think that is something that will absolutely help benefit expanding your world as a person just in general. So I think that definitely makes sense and rings true with me. Also, if folks are new to the show and if we're talking about certain concepts that you're not that familiar with, if you go back to our episode 4, we get into a lot of like retirement accounts. And then the last thing that strikes me in what you're talking about as far as having habits, we also talked about a book in previous episodes called The Behavioral Investor by Daniel Crosby. And there's a lot of those concepts of making sure that you can automate those behaviors. So if it's $100 a month, whatever budgeting wise you can do, make sure that you are automatically doing that. Lock it in, so to speak. Don't be so sort of scared by what could happen in the stock market and so on. Just make sure that you are being consistent and having consistent investment strategies. And history has shown that it will benefit you way more than completely staying out of the market and not having a plan for investing.
Certainly. And one of the stories I recount in the book, just to give you an idea of this this habit aspect, I spend a chapter on the cathedrals, cathedrals builders in the Middle Ages, how people actually build cathedrals. I'm talking about cathedrals in Europe, these Gothic cathedrals you see in France, in Germany, how they build them with very few resources, with extreme constraints, because it was very cold, people could not speak the same language, technology was very low. I mean, there were a lot of constraints, a lot of problems, but the way they build them, I mean, just I'm just summarizing the book in this area. The way they managed to do these amazing things is like building assets. I mean, you say, after 20 years, I built a fortune, I built a cathedral. How did they do it? Well, one of the main principles is that they build systems. They build habits that could sustain any kind of disruptions. When it was very cold outside and people could not work, they develop habits to be able to work inside, to work indoors. They built houses for the masons, and they could continue to work in the winter when the temperature was very low. They developed a standardization, and they standardized the size of the stones to be able to work faster. They develop communication systems to be able to communicate to the workers what they have to do, because they spoke 20 different languages. I mean, they developed these habits that allow them to build cathedrals. And if you're going to invest, or you're going to do anything, if you're going to learn Spanish, or you're going to develop some skills in some area, you have to develop these habits of productivity, of self-discipline, because in the end, it is what gets in them. It is not magical knowledge that is going to tell you in which company to invest or which ETF to buy. I mean, when you're starting out, nobody knows the answer. I mean, you have to learn it. But if you spend every week a couple of hours, you will learn relatively quickly. I always compare investing, personal finance, with learning a language. Because it's exactly the same. I mean, if you see people speaking several languages, it seems like magic. I say, how could you learn Spanish or German or French if you live in New York? Well, the answer is always the same, little by little. I mean, you spend every day 10 minutes, 15 minutes, you practice a little bit, you learn some words, then you forget them, then you learn them again, then you make mistakes, then you correct. And eventually, there is a point where you can speak the language. And it seems like magic, but investment is exactly the same. You learn a little by little, you invest $50, you invest $100, you use ETFs, you use brokers, you make mistakes. Sometimes you lose what you invested because you make a stupid decision, but you will not lose too much if you diversify. And after a few years, you are amazingly good because you just learned the basics, you went through the learning curve, and then you are confident enough to say, this is a good investment, this is not good, and then you just grow and grow and grow. And by the time you are 60 or 70 or 80, you have substantial assets. So I just want to give the message that developing the right habits is the key to investing successfully. It's more important doing that than actually having someone tell you to buy shares of I don't know, Apple or Amazon. Try to develop your skills, to develop your habits, because those will make you successful in any circumstances.
Do you have any particular books or resources that you would point folks to that are brand new? They're either ones that you've come across that you've read personally that have helped, or any other resources?
Yeah. Well, okay. First, I recommend my books.
Sure.
Many of them deal with aspects of personal finance. But I would certainly recommend people to, I assume that most people are going to have a mobile phone, a smartphone, to use a kind of RSS of the newsreader to read financial blogs or to read news. Because it takes you every day, it's going to take you 10 minutes, 15 minutes to go through the headlines. And if you just subscribe to, they are free, and you just subscribe to different financial publications in your RSS reader on the phone, you can get more information in 10 minutes that you will get in, 1 year of watching TV. Because you can compare different headlines, you can see different approaches, different interpretations of different news. This is for free. I mean, you can do it for free on your smartphone. It's a very, very useful way to learn. And you have to try different websites to see what you do. I mean, most of the financial publications or the newspapers, they have free access to their blog. And you can get it on your smartphone, on your tablet. This is a very good thing to do. I do it myself already for years. You can spend 10 minutes a day, but you will become much wiser because you will have access to different sources of information. Very, very easy. Very, very well written, most of them. And this is one of the great advantages of living in the 21st century. So use it because it's free. And you will learn so much in after you do this for a few weeks, you will become, I think, much, much wiser. And your views of the world will become much more balanced.
Well, and as you mentioned, yes, I should have said, goes without saying, check out your books for sure, as well as some of the other resources that you were talking about. And of course, the most recent one, Undisrupted, How Highly Effective People Deal with Disruptions. And John, I really appreciate you being on the show today. Do you want to go ahead and give folks your contact information, social media, and also, of course, all the places that they can find your books?
Yeah, and very, very easy to find. If you just type my name on Google or any search engine, John Vespasian, you will find in 1 second my books, my blog. There are hundreds of free articles. There is a free newsletter. Just type John Vespasian on Google. You will find everything in 1 second. It's very, very easy to find.
Great. Well, before I let you go, is there anything that we missed that we should go over today?
Yes, I just like to close just with one piece of advice. For people to be a bit patient, because today in the 21st century, you find very few people who read books, maybe 3% of the population, because everybody wants to learn the secrets of life by reading some blog post of 200 words, or by listening to a podcast, or by watching TV, which is fine. But you have to read. You have to read books. You have to read biographies, you have to read history, because the wisdom you can gain from other people is the cheapest way of education. I mean, you can watch TV for 10 years, but if you read a few books per year, your level of knowledge will increase, you will become more thoughtful, you will have better language skills, and this cannot be replaced. I find it very dangerous when children nowadays they are educated on the basic of on the basis of PowerPoint presentations, Wikipedia, copy paste. This is very dangerous. You want to have a perspective. You want to go through the learning curve. You want to have real knowledge. You have to read, and you have to read books. Take your time. Buy pocket books. Buy cheap books. Buy secondhand books. Buy read books. If you don't read books, it's very difficult to move forward.
I think that is great advice and certainly a good place for us to just conclude today. Well, I really appreciate you being on the show. I had a lot of fun going through your book and some of the examples, and I could talk about finances and all this kind of stuff all day, but we'll leave it at that for now. And if you'd like to come back on at a later time, you have an open invite.
Many thanks, Greg. Thanks for having me. And I wish you a great weekend.
If you enjoyed this episode, please leave us a review on Apple, Spotify, Google Play, or wherever you get podcasts. If you'd like to be notified of future weekly episodes, please hit the subscribe button. If you'd like to help us even further, visit suburbanfolk.com and you'll find a donate button where all the money goes back into the show for you. Thanks for listening.
The following is a message from Tatnus Co. All right, tatnusco.com is just about ready to launch.
Hey, what if we added a blog section so fans get to know more about who Tatnus is?
You know, that's actually not really a bad idea. All right, that should do it.
This link is not working.
Are you kidding me? We gotta get this done. All right, cool. There, we fixed it. Now we can launch this thing, right?
Hey, did you remember to add the privacy policy?
Mother it may have taken a while, but tatnusco.com is finally up and live and open for business. And yes, we remember the privacy policy.
Thank you so much. It's been emotional.